Good evening, everyone. Thank you for coming. We'll speak in the next hour about a few different things. I know that almost all the people over here, they have emunah. They have faith. They believe in God. They know we, the Jewish people, got the Torah from Hashem. And as results of that, it made us the chosen people, special nation. The problem is knowing there is a God, knowing that God gave the Jewish people the Torah, does not mean that much. Almost all the goyim knows it. Every Arab you ask, every Arab terrorist murderer, you believe in God? Yes. You believe that he gave the Torah to the Jewish people and they are the children of Ibrahim, Isaac, and Yaakov? Of course, every Arab will tell you that. Every terrorist. So it's not such a great thing to believe there is a God. If you don't believe there is a God, you're not a normal human being. You have to be put in a mental institution. Because if someone would say that this bottle was made by itself, and you believe it, you're not normal. I definitely don't want my daughter to marry you, that's for sure. Because if somebody say that something was made by itself, this world was made by itself, nobody made it, the rest of the nonsense that we hear, obviously these kind of people either are liars or are not normal, one of the two. There's no in between. That's why I don't want to insult your intelligence and talk to you about if there is a God or not. I already assume all of you are normal and you have a brain on your shoulder and it's not brainless. Your head is not brainless. You have a brain. And I'll go to the next level thinking, I also give you the benefits of the doubt that you're smart enough and traditional enough to know that we actually got the Torah in a public event in front of millions of witnesses. If you're not sure, I brought you a lot of CDs here. Please take some of the CDs I brought called Torah and Science. Over there, you have one proof after the other. It leaves no doubt. Once you watch it, you know 1,000,000% that our Torah is the only book that God gave. Not that it's the book of God. It's the only book that he gave. Not Christianity, not Islam, not Buddhism, not Hinduism, and not 80,000 other religions and cults. None of this. So since we know there is a God, and we know he gave us the Torah, the question is, what are we going to do with that? Most of the people in the world believe in God. 70% at least admit they believe in God, and they believe in the Torah. Even Goyim. Even Goyim believes in it. But what are they doing with this knowledge? That's a very big problem. Over here, we are totally bankrupt. Because knowing and not following, it's worse than not knowing. What's better? To be meshuga, to be crazy, not to believe that the world has a God, not to believe in religion, what they call today an atheist, or to be a believer and do not listen to your creator. Which one of the two is worse? Which one of the two is worse? I always say that I admire people that come to me and say, I'm not going to do Brit Milah to my son. They tell me, Rabbi, you normal? You're supposed to teach people to do Brit Milah. What do you mean you admire people like this? And my answer is, that I admire them because they are not fakers. I cannot see Jewish traditional people who believe in God and believe in the Torah and will do Brit Milah and then break Shabbat an hour later. I just can't see it. Because to break Shabbat according to the Torah, it's a bigger crime than a murder. And as a bigger punishment than to murder someone. And none of you is going to kill anyone. Because you know God is going to punish you. That's the only reason we don't kill. Because even if you know there's no police, no nothing, you're still afraid. How can I take someone's life away? So by breaking Shabbat, you're actually making a bigger crime. So why you kill yourself so much to do Brit Milah, and at the same time you're making sins that are a million times worse? So when someone comes to me and say to me, I'm not religious. I don't believe in God. I don't believe in the Torah. For me, I don't believe in none of that. I don't believe in religion. That's why I'm not going to do Brit Milah. At least he's honest. He follow what he believes. He is ignorant. Bur v'am haaretz, because he never read the Torah. If he knew the Torah, he would run to keep the mitzvot. But why I prefer a guy like this than someone who does whatever he likes? Because when I deal with a Jew that does whatever he likes, I know he's a faker. Everything in his life is fake. He only do what's easy for him, not what needs to be done. That's why I know that even if I prove to him that the Torah is the book of God, he's going to put an X on it. Because he's going to continue to do what he likes. He doesn't care about the truth. But when I come to this atheist that doesn't believe in anything, and I convince him and prove to him that the Torah is the book of God, what do you think will happen? Since his nature is honest, and he went 100% with his belief, I change his belief, I change his entire life. After I prove to him the Torah is from God, he cannot anymore ignore it. And that's what I did, Baruch Hashem, many, many thousands of times. People that say to me, I don't believe in anything, anything. Once I prove to them the Torah is real, that's it. They started to keep. I'm more concerned about Jews that say to me, Rabbi, I believe in the Torah, of course. But I do whatever I like. This one is too hard for me. This one is not for me. This one used to be. This one doesn't apply. This one is hard. When I'll get married, I'll do it. How many times people told me, Rabbi, I will keep Shabbat when I get married. Right now I'm alone. It's very hard for me to be alone on Shabbat. Where does it say in the Torah that being alone or being with the family has something to do with keeping Shabbat? It's like someone comes to you, Rabbi, I'm going to stop murdering people when the day I get married. Right now I'm alone. You know, it's easy for me. It's a good job, good income. I have no responsibility, no wife, no children, so I go, I kill. One day I'll get married, I'll stop. Come on. What does it have to do if you're single, or if you're married, if you have children? This is the book of God. And he gave us instruction how we have to live. And he told us, if you listen to me, I will reward you big time, forever, for eternity. And if you ignore me and you do whatever you like, you're going to pay the price. And that's the problem that most of the Jews do not aware of. They're not aware of. What they're not aware of? They don't understand that if this is a book that the creator of the world gave me, gave him, gave her, gave everybody over here, there's no difference between me and him and him and her. There's no difference. It applies to each one of us. Thank you. That's why if we ignore it, we have to understand that soon or later we will deal with the consequences. We're going to deal with what we cook. What you cook, you must eat. You cannot run away. Whatever you cook for yourself, you will be forced to eat. Now I'll tell you something that confuses you very much. In the world of lies, the world that we live in today, it seems that most criminals get away with the crimes. There's a lot of mafia people, 30 years already they kill people and nobody touched them. They're untouchable. They are corrupted politicians that became the president of the United States. Nobody touched them. There's pedophiles and they are rapists and they are big thieves and they are cheaters. And there's all kinds of people who seems to be that they get away with the crimes. As a result of that, we, the not such smart people, we think that there is a way to get away with my crimes against God. Here, for 20 years I break Shabbat and nothing happens to me. It's not so bad. I'll take my chances. I want to assure each one of you, to assure you a million times, nobody ever got away with one little crime against Hashem. Even when you eat bread and you don't wash your hands, you must get your punishment for that and it will come sooner or later. Nobody ever ran for anything, not from stealing, not from killing, not from breaking Shabbat, not from dressing, not modest. There's only one thing that confuses many people. In the law here in America or in any country, once the police of the FBI found out that you are guilty, they have enough evidence against you, they don't wait a second. Quickly they run and arrest you, and right away they press charges against you in a day or two. They're not going to wait 20 years until they're going to be in a mood to give you the punishment. If they caught you killing someone now, tomorrow you'll be arrested when they catch you. That's it. By Hashem, it doesn't work like this. He can see you making crimes 30 years. Not only did not arrest you yet, not only did not give you what you deserve yet, he actually helps you to continue with your crimes. He defends you, he gives you oxygen, he gives you money, he gave you wife and children, business is booming, you get new car every year, you're healthy, you run, you do sport, you look very good. Everything looks beautiful in your life. That's the mistake. That you think, if God was so angry at me, why did he give me all this wealth? Why did he give me health? Why he didn't kill me a long time ago? Because according to the Torah, I should have been dead already a million times before. And I'm still running, and look what a beautiful wife he just gave me. Look what a beautiful baby he just gave me. This is the confusion that a lot of people have. If God hates me so much, like the Torah say, why he gives me such a success? I'll give you an example. Person is gay. Gay. He lives with a boyfriend in his house. The Torah says gay people that act on their desires, they have to be put to death by stoning. And it's also a cut for their soul in the afterlife. ונחרטו הנפשות האלה. Cut. It's a cut for the soul. If there was Sanhedrin today, if we had a big court in the time of Beit HaMikdash, and they found a gay person that act on his sin, and they warn him, and he did it again, and he got caught again, that's it. There's no more forgiveness. They must execute him by the court of law according to the Torah. How many gays do you have in the world? Millions, hundreds of millions, who knows how many. They all act, they all do whatever they want, they dance naked on the street in all these parades that they do. Many of them are big designers, many of them big own hotels, many of them own a lot of things, all kinds of things like this. It looks to you that where is the justice? Everything looks, there's no justice. There is a Talmid Yeshiva, learn Gemara from morning to night for 10 years, barely have enough to eat and to feed his children. And this criminal who makes millions of people follow his despicable things and abomination, and he makes millions, and in every magazine you see his picture, and he's a movie star, and he's a big singer, and everybody listens to his music, so where is the justice? The Torah already said that the reaction of Hashem is not instant. It doesn't come right away. This is the difference between people to God. We cannot wait a second to take revenge against our enemy. If a person kills your mother and he just is in your hand right now, you're going to do everything you can to bring him to justice or to do other things to him, which I cannot say in front of a camera. But everybody will not wait a minute. I can wait another hour. But Hashem can tell him, go, you're free. Here is $1 million on your next real estate deal. Here is sushi, and here is Ashpolo, and here is Osavo, and here is Gudguje. Enjoy, buy a nice house in Jamaica Mistake. Everything is booming. You can continue to do Medicaid fraud. Don't worry. I'm with you. You can continue to be Mechalel Shabbat. You can continue to kill your enemies and make lies about them in the internet. You can do this and you can do that. You can continue with your Goya girlfriend. You can continue to be gay. You do whatever you like. I'm with you. That's an illusion. What is the bottom line the Torah say? In the end, everyone must pay. Now I know what you're thinking, so it's not fair. What, God is helping me to get destroyed? Why he does not take care of me right away? Why he's waiting another 30 years And then he's going to come and give me the punishment which I cannot get out of it. He should have given me a punch 30 years earlier. The answer is because the Torah already told you what's right and what's wrong. The Torah say, I give everyone what they deserve. Eventually, everyone must pay for good or for bad. This is one of the 13 principles of Judaism. That HaKadosh Baruch Hu pay reward to the tzaddikim and punish the reshaim. If a goy comes to convert and you tell him, do you believe in the 13 principle of Judaism? You want to be a Jew? That's the first step. You must believe in the 13 principle of the Torah. Do you believe? He say, I believe in everything except one. You're not allowed to convert him. You cannot make him a Jew. You cannot take him to the mikveh, no brit milah, no nothing. Why? Because he say, one thing here I don't believe in. You can never be a Jew. One of the 13 principles in Judaism is that HaKadosh Baruch Hu must give good to the righteous, to the tzaddikim, and must punish the wicked. Must. He has no choice. Even if he wants to let somebody go, he can't. Who can tell me why? Why? If I'm the judge of the world, I can let anyone I want go, right? If I'm sitting in a court in Manhattan, and I'm a Jew, and a Jewish guy came, and I know him, friend of mine from high school, used to do favors for me. Now I'm his judge. I'm supposed to decide if he goes to jail for 20 years or only for 3 years. And I like him. It's up to me. I can say, well, listen, this guy, this, that, this, find all kinds of reasons, give an answer, 3 years only. After a good behaving discount, 2 years later, he's back on the street. I could have put him 20 years. I put him 2-3 years. It's up to me. I'm the judge. Over here, you can do whatever you want, even if you're a judge. Police can be corrupted, judge can be corrupted, no problem. By Hashem, he cannot be corrupted. Why? Because it's against the Torah. I'll explain. When Hashem gave us the Torah, it's written a few times in the Torah, I am the God of justice, the God of the truth, the God of honesty. I cannot stand no honesty. I cannot stand corruption. I cannot stand stealing. I cannot stand lies. Stay away from lies. Midvar sheker tirchak. So there are such strict laws when it comes to honesty. If I call myself, I am the God of justice that will not take bribe from anyone and must give everyone exactly what they deserve. And then I let one mechalel Shabbat get away with his punishment. I like him. Why? His grandfather was a very big mullah in Bukhara. So I like him. His grandfather was a good guy. So I let him go. If I do such a thing, I cannot be called anymore the God of justice. But there's a much bigger problem than this. The whole point of Judaism is that you will never find one mistake in the Torah, ever. Because this is a divine book. That's why all the prophecies will always happen. Every good prophecy that the Torah spoke about happened. All the warnings that Hashem warned us happened. Everything the Torah say must happen. All the things the Torah say must be true. If you find one mistake in the Torah, then you know this Torah is not from God. Because God does not make mistakes. So if God say, I am the God of justice, I'm a fair God, I judge everyone equal. And then one time in a history, he's not going to give Mechalel Shabbat that died without doing tshuva, without making repentance. He died being Mechalel Shabbat. And in the end, he will not give him the punishment that the Torah say. What will happen at that moment? The entire Torah just got dismissed. Got canceled and there's no more Judaism. Everything is over. No more Yom Kippur, no more nothing. Why? Because all the tzaddikim of all the generation who worked very hard to make it to heaven will know that moment that this God, God forbid, lied to us. He's not an honest God. And that means that the Torah is a lie. Because the Torah promised that something like this will never happen. So even if he wants to let you go, he can't. because that's going to break the truth of the Torah and will cancel the entire religion. That's why if any one of you count that I can do whatever I want, and when I come in front of Hashem when I die, I will manage with him, please take this illusion out of your head. Be smart and listen to my advice. I'm not saying that from today to tomorrow you can become a big rabbi. It takes time. It takes time to become religious, and even when you become religious, every month you can be more and more and more and better and better. The main thing the Torah says, "Ptach li petach kepitcho shel machat, ve'eftach lecha kepitcho shel ulam." Open me a hole the size of a needle. Make the first step towards me. This is what Hashem say to each one of us. Make the first step, and I will open you the whole world. What does it mean, make the first step? There can be many different steps. One example is, before you go to sleep, you take the Siddur, you say Shema Yisrael, 2 minutes. 2 minutes a day. Shema Yisrael, Hashem Elokeinu Hashem Echad, ve'ahavta et Hashem Elokecha, until Hashem Elokechem Emet. Then you go to sleep. But before you go to sleep, you speak to Hashem 2-3 minutes with your own words. Dear God, I love you. I appreciate what you gave me. Thank you, I'm healthy. Thank you, I have a wife. Thank you, I have children. Thank you, I have a place to sleep. Thank you, I have a car. Thank you for all the thank you for making me Jewish. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to understand what to do in life. Thank you for saving me from all kinds of problems. Help me to be close to you every day, closer and closer. Help me to be strong. Help me to follow the truth. Help me to win against my evil inclination, against my desires, against my weaknesses. Save me from my enemies. Help me to find a wife to get married to if he's single. Help me to find a husband. Help me to have good children. Help me, help me, help me. Help me with my parnasa. Help me with my problem in court. Everyone with his problems, and everyone have problems. Everyone. There's not one person dismissed from problems. There's problems on a daily basis because this is what Hashem wants. If none of us would have problems, what would be the end of us? Most of the people, by the way, they're religious because they're afraid that Hashem will take away their money. Not because it's the right thing to do. You should know that. If Hashem will come to people and say to them, here, I'm giving you a personal guarantee, the $100 million that you have right now will never be lost. It's secure. You will always have at least $100 million, no matter what you do. Always. And this is a religious person, half of these people in 1 month will become half not religious. They're not so much uptight anymore. Why? Many people are afraid. They believe in God and they know he's going to punish me. And usually the easiest punishment is with money. After that, it goes to the body. Health problem, accidents, breaking, problems like this, surgeries. And after that, death. First, property, money, real estate problem, tickets, accident, engine died, all kinds of things like this. You lost your suitcase. Things that happens to us all the time. That's a warning. If it doesn't help, then it goes into the body. Problems here, problem there, 2 months hospital, this, that. It doesn't help. It can come to a point that a person died. And many people die. 8% of the people in Israel do not make it to age 45%. 6.8, I'm sorry. Today they published the statistic. A lot of people don't even make it to 45. 45 is a very young age, especially today. You're athlete, you run, you do, you play tennis. 45, you didn't even marry one kid yet. A lot of people die. It's many thousands of people. 20-something percent of the death comes from cancer. 14% come from heart attack. Heart attacks come usually from stress. People are stressed. Pressure in a work, pressure in a money, pressure in a family, pressure with a lot of pressure. And the pressure kills people. There's a lot of problems in life. We should go back to what I started with. The Torah says, that before Hashem gave us the Torah, first He gave us the Shabbat. He had to give us Shabbat before He even gave us the Torah. Why? Because before you give a person a gift, you first have to make an agreement with him. You give him something, you sign the documents, no? First sign here, sign. Here is the key of the house. This is already the gift that comes later. But first you make a treaty, an agreement. Shabbat is the agreement between Hashem and the Jewish people. After Hashem said to the Jewish people, I chose you to be my children because of Avraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov. Your parents were very big tzaddikim. I swore to them that I will never replace their children with any other nation. Therefore, I must bring them to the Holy Land. I will build a temple for them, which is a house for me to live among them. And I will always protect them from the goyim. I will give them punishments for their sins. There will be a lot of problems. But I can never replace them with any other nation. And who knows what's the agreement between the Jewish people and Hashem? What's the agreement? Shabbat is the agreement. Shabbat is the foundation of everything. The whole building, you have a building, 100 floors. You have big foundation, deep in the ground, solid, cement, thick. If the foundation is not good, it doesn't matter. You have 100 floors. Sooner or later, they all will collapse. Shabbat is the foundation of everything. That's why the Torah says, Shabbat, hi mekor haberacha. It's the source of all the blessing in life. If you do not keep Shabbat, doesn't matter how much money you make, you can make billions, you will never enjoy your money. Never. You will never have blessing. Always problem, always lawsuits, always fighting with the partners, always IRS issues, always divorce issue, problem, fighting in court, fighting with competition. There is no blessing in your life. No blessing with your children, no blessing with your health. You will never be happy. You will always be sad and upset and aggravated because Hashem made a rule in life. Shabbat is the source of all blessing. Shabbat is mekor habracha. Mekor means source. Bracha means blessing. Everybody wants blessing. Some people, even not religious, they stand for hours to go into a big rabbi to give him a blessing. What do you need a rabbi for? You have the creator of the world. He told you the source of all blessing is Shabbat. If a Jewish person does not keep Shabbat, the Torah say, not me, the Torah, that is not considered Jewish. If he dies, you're not allowed to bury him in a Jewish cemetery. Did you know that? If someone who drives a car on Shabbat, speaking on the phone on Shabbat, computer, television, cigarette, if he breaks Shabbat and he die without doing tshuva before he died, if he did tshuva, even when he was 50, 60, 70, before he died, he did tshuva and started to keep Shabbat. He was ashamed that he broke Shabbat. He regretted, and he did everything he could, and now he's keeping Shabbat. And then Yom Kippur came, and he said, Chatati, Aviti, Pashati, and he gave tzedakah. So someone like this, he did tshuva. All the Shabbatot he did not keep, he lost the reward. Hashem doesn't have any reward to give him, because he did not keep. But at least he gets saved from the punishment in the next world. And also is considered that he died like a Jew. But if he die and is not Shomer Shabbat, in the time of his death, first of all, his soul is getting cut out of the Jewish nation for eternity. It's written in the Torah, V'shamru bnei Israel et ha-Shabbat. The nation of Israel observed the Sabbath. לעשות את השבת לדורותם ברית עולם. To make Shabbat for generations. ברית עולם. Eternal covenant. Eternal agreement. ביני ובין בני ישראל אות היא לעולם. Between me and the nation of Israel, it's a sign for eternity. לעולם means for eternity. It's a sign for eternity. Sign for what? That I created the world in 6 days. And in 7 days I did not create anything. I rested. כי ששת ימים עשה השם את השמיים ואת הארץ, וביום השביעי שבת וינפש. And the 7 day Hashem went on rest. Strike. It did not create even one little bug. Nothing. That's why Hashem said to the Jewish people, you are my children. Children have to follow their father. I did not do anything on Shabbat. I did not create fire. I did not create anything. You are not allowed to create on Shabbat. You can work. You can sweat. You can break your back. You can pick up this table up and down 100 times. You can clean. You can wash dishes. You can serve food. It's no problem. But you cannot create. I give you an example. If you have 300 guests in your big mansion, they came for your son's bar mitzvah for Shabbat. The wife worked like a slave the entire Shabbat. Serving, plates, collecting, changing the tablecloths, bringing dessert, washing the dishes, drying them, putting new food, bringing again food, moving chairs, picking up tables, bringing it down, go down to the garage, bring more stuff. The whole Shabbat she worked like a slave. She didn't break Shabbat. It's not about hard work. She turned the light one time on. What is it? With the remote. Tak. She broke Shabbat. It's nothing to do with hard work. It's nothing to do with sweating. Not like some people think. Oh, in the old days, it was very hard to make fire. You needed 2 racks. So Hashem didn't want people the whole Shabbat to try to make fire. So he said, don't create fire. This is ignorant. This is stupid. Because first of all, what do you think? People, every time they wanted to make fire, they need to take 2 racks? They didn't have electric, so you need light in the house. So they had buckets with oil, and they had fire around the entire house. If you live in a cave or you live in a cabin, so you had to have light. So you always had fire on. All you have to do is to take from existing fire and create new fire, like we do on Yom Tov. And it's still not allowed on Shabbat. Even to take from existing fire, this is 2 candles, you have one is on. You want to take from here with a match and light this one, you're not allowed on Shabbat. It's nothing to do with hard work. You're not allowed to create anything on Shabbat. This is a spiritual decree. And the Torah says, if you break Shabbat, you are not Jewish. Now, how many people here, it bothers them that the Torah says, not me, that Mechalel Shabbat Hareu Kegoy Lechol Davar. 100% Ahmed. Who here it bothers him? Raise his hand. Don't be afraid.
Can you translate?
Translate to what?
Explain more details.
What did I just do for 10 minutes? I just say, if you break Shabbat, the Torah say you are not considered a Jew. And if a person die while he's Mechalel Shabbat, they can't bury him with the Shomrei Shabbat. They have to bury him in a section like a goy, on a different side of the wall. So the question is, when you hear such a thing, assuming you're not Shomer Shabbat, does it burn your heart? Or big deal, no big deal.
Yeah. These days, you know, with everybody as easily as it is to access this knowledge, and with the ignorance that goes around, you can never tell who actually makes this tshuva on their deathbed. So who do you know that you can, for all we know, we have been buried in Mechalel Shabbat next to...
We go by certainty, by chazaka. If a person, for instance, Mechalel Shabbat died in an accident, we know he did not make tshuva. He died, that's it. It was an accident, or he drowned, or something like this. If he did make tshuva, we have no way to know. So the Torah says that anyone who died as Mechalel Shabbat, meaning he never kept Shabbat, we did not see him keeping Shabbat, we have to assume that he died without tshuva. If he did tshuva, that's between him and Hashem. He's buried in a different section. However, you should know in the old days, they used to execute people that are not keeping Shabbat. So before they execute them, they did tshuva. Tati, Aviti, I'm sorry, forgive me. After they do tshuva, they kill them by stoning. That's what Hashem said to do to Mechalelei Shabbat. Just to show you how big of a crime it is. That even murderers don't get death by stoning. Murderers don't get such a punishment. Did you know that a murderer that keeps Shabbat is considered to be a Jew? Mechalel Shabbat, that is the nicest Jew, he does not even kill a bug. Such a soft, nice person, such nice, friendly, such a generous guy, such a polite guy, but he's breaking Shabbat. Mechalel Shabbat gets in the elevator, press the button, smoke, whatever he does. This nice guy is 100% like a goy. And this murderer monster, but he's Shomer Shabbat, is still considered a Jew. It's hard to believe. The Torah says, "En kovrim rasha gadol etzel rasha katan." If you have now two different wicked people, one is wicked, but one is even more wicked, you don't bury them together. You make a section for them and a section for them. I give you an example. If you have a section, in the old days, everyone kept Shabbat. Everyone. Until 220 years, you couldn't find Jews that don't keep Shabbat. All over the world, everyone was keeping Shabbat. Everyone. In all over Europe, in Bukhara, in Iraq, Iran, everyone was Shomer Shabbat. Everyone had beards, everyone had hats, everyone had turbans. There was only kosher meat by the shochet. The rabbi was the head of the communities. We were isolated from the goyim. The Jews all lived together. There's no such thing, colleges. All the problem of the Jewish people started from Moshe Mendelssohn. 220 years ago in Europe, he went to college. An Orthodox rabbi. College brought destruction on the Jewish people. Once he went to goyim college, started to learn what the goyim have to say with all the women there and everything. His children followed him. They all married goyot and converted to Christianity. 150 years later, close to 80% of the Jewish people in Europe already married goyim. And that's when Hashem brought the Holocaust and killed millions of the people in Europe, as you know. And after that, we started another 80 years since then until today. The situation in America today is nothing better. It's actually worse than what it was before the Holocaust in Europe. Today in America, 80% assimilation, 80% intermarriage. Horrible things come from these colleges, kfira, infidels all over, non-stop brainwash against Hashem. That's what comes from these colleges today. Evolution, the world is billions of years old, making fun at religion. Their God is science today in the university. The real God of the academic people is science. That's the God they admire. So that's what's happening today. Same thing happened before the Holocaust is happening today. Most of the American Jews are either totally secular like goyim, or reform Jews, which is worse than goyim, or conservative Jews, which is like reform Jews, which is worse than goyim. This is the reality today here. Now you, Baruch Hashem, if you come to listen to a Torah lecture, especially from me, that I do not leave anything in my pocket, and I say it as it is. That's my rule. Rule number one by me, you must say the truth to the people. What they want to do with that, it's their problem, not mine. But I'm not going to be a hypocrite sitting here and telling you you're all righteous and you have nothing to worry. Leave it to the fakers to do it. By me, I come and I tell you the truth. That's it. I don't want anything from you. So why shouldn't I tell you the truth? If I came to kiss up to you, give me money, I need your money, I need your help. Obviously, the more strict I'm with you, the more you get angry at me. Right? But since I didn't come to take anything from you, I only came to do you a favor. What is the favor? To wake you up before Chas v'Shalom, God forbid, a million times, God forbid, you would lose your eternal life. And no punishment come even near such a punishment. That when you die, Hashem say to you, I'm sorry, you're not Jewish for me. You cut Judaism out of your life. That's why you die like a goy. And now you're going to go to a horrible place and you're going to pay for all your crimes. And this is my job, to try to prevent this from happening. That's called pikuach nefesh. But pikuach nefesh, not on the body. Body, big deal. Body die. in 20 years, in 30, 40 years, we'll all be dead anyway. Body, it's temporary. Life over here is very short. I'm not worried about the life over here. That's not my priority right now. I'm worried about something much more important. What is it? The life of the soul. Where is your soul gonna end? Will it end in heaven with all the tzaddikim, like your grandparents and their grandparents, all the way to Moshe Rabbeinu? Or will it end in the most horrible place that if I will describe to you what happened to there, to the people that go there, in 1 minute you all faint. If you know how big is the punishments that the Mechalelei Shabbat gets, and the rapist, and the thieves, and all the other people, you won't believe how can it be so strict. But I'm not here to go into details. I hope that you're smart enough that after I leave this room, you're gonna sit and think. If there is 10% chance that what he says is true, after I leave, you have to think, and this is what you have to think. If there is only 10% chance that what he says is true, not 90%, 10%. 10%, I cannot ever break Shabbat ever again. Because for 1%, I can still not do it. Because if someone tell me, before you drink from this bottle, there's 100 bottles on the table, and in one of them we put poison. But we're not sure which one, they all got mixed. And I'm very thirsty, very thirsty. But there's 100 bottles here. And when I pick up this bottle, my hands is shaking. So Shaulov is asking me, Rabbi, why your hands are shaking? I said, well, because there is a 1% chance that this bottle have terrible poison and I'll be dead in a minute. But on the other hand, I'm very thirsty and I'm dizzy. I did not drink for 3 days. My head is pounding. I feel I'm fainting. So I don't know what to do. Should I drink or should I wait until tomorrow when I have safe water? What would you do? Same. Who would drink? Huh? Anyone would drink? Because anyone that would drink, he doesn't need to be religious. That means he's not normal. The Torah says someone is not normal, doesn't have to be religious. He's dismissed. Why? Because crazy people, they don't have to keep mitzvot because they're crazy. They're patur. Shoteh patur mi mitzvot. Anyone that would drink, that means it's shoteh. It's like a little kid, 2 years old, he would drink. If you tell your 2 years old, hey, don't drink. Maybe there's poison over here. He would laugh. And drink. Right? Because he's 2 years old. Even 4 years old wouldn't drink. But if he gets already 6 years old, he's a clever boy, he won't touch. Even he's very thirsty. Why he won't touch? Because he's smart. So you're worse than him? Who would take 1% chance to drink from poison? No one. So I'm asking you, every one of you know that there is much more than 1% chance that the Torah is from God. Right? You agree with me on that? 1% you give, no? You give 1% or no?
Yes.
Anyone that doesn't think that there's a 1% chance?
No shote over here.
How do I know that all of you believe that the Torah is from God in a very high percentage? How do I know? You would not waste 2 hours of your time coming here. Who would come to a Torah speech, huh? When he can, I don't know, watch games or go watch a movie or do who knows what. And even if you came for the good Bukharian food or the sushi, when I speak, you would go out to the terrace or check your messages outside. You wouldn't waste a minute on me if you're convinced that the Torah is not from God. Why should you waste your time, right? If I would go to my friend, he would bring a Muslim speaker to speak about the Quran. Will I waste a minute there? No, because for me, I already know it's not from God. That's why I would not waste a minute there. So all of you know there is more than 1% chance that Torah is from God. So the question is, how is it possible that you dare to break Shabbat? When you read in the Torah that the Torah say, Mechalel Shabbat mot yumat, mot ba'olam hazeh, and yumat ba'olam haba, v'nichreta ha'nefesh ha'i me'ameh. That's about me. You have to think. Who is he talking about, God, here? He's talking about me, my wife, my children, my brother, my sister, every one of my friends. This is going to be our end. How can we stay and do nothing about it. So far, any questions? Yes.
So, you said that the people who are Mechalel Shabbat, they usually just continue the cycle. But what about the people who are Mechalel Shabbat today, who are living off of the zikiyot of their grandparents? Who their grandparents were righteous to the king?
There is such thing that people benefit from the merit of their parents and grandparents. It's called Zchut Avot. But this Zchut Avot has a price. It helps you for the time being. But when a person dies wicked, he has to be judged. And all the bonus and the gifts that he got in his life, thanks to his grandfather or father, now he's going to get the bill. You have to pay for it. If I made you a very rich guy because your grandfather was the chief rabbi of Morocco and he was a very holy man, and as a result of that, out of respect to him, I gave his grandson hundreds of millions. But what does it mean? That he's dismissed from the punishment? Now I'm going to check what he did with the money, who did he give tzedakah, who he did not give, how honest he was, how he kept Shabbat, what did he do in his life? In the end, like I told you, everybody must pay for everything he did, unless there's one way to erase it from your file. And it's a lot easier than to erase it from your file here in a court of New York. If you have 20 counts against you in a court of New York, you cannot erase even one. To the last thing, they go after you. But with Hashem, you can have thousands of things pending against you. Thousands. 1 week of good tshuva, you can erase everything. I give you an example. It's enough that right now you're sitting over here now listening to me. There are two kinds of people sitting here. Some thinking, who is this crazy guy came to ruin my night here, telling me all this nonsense. I wish I can choke him to death. And the other ones are thinking, wow, how did I not think about what he said before? I mean, after all, my grandfather was religious. All my family, a lot of my cousins, a lot of my parents maybe. And I know the truth. Maybe I didn't know to that point, but come on, how did I become like this? How didn't I think about it before? It's time to change. And you're already thinking while I'm speaking right now about this coming Shabbat, how are you going to keep it? I know from experience. Some people, they would leave the lecture angry and they'll tell the host, next time when this guy comes, make sure not to invite me. No problem. Those are fakers. People that cannot handle the truth. They know I'm right. They know I'm not making it up. They know the chance that I come and make up stuff that is not written in the Torah or in Shulchan Aruch does not exist. They know it. Because all you have to do is to tell me, show me where it says it. On a spot. You can tell me right now, I don't believe that Mechalel Shabbat is like a goy. Can you prove it to me? I don't believe that the soul is going to be cut from eternity. Where does it say such thing? Where does it say you cannot bury Shomer Shabbat, Mechalel Shabbat with Shomrei Shabbat? Where does it say you cannot be a witness? Where does it say this and this and this and that? Where? I will show you where. I made a whole film about Shabbat with sources for the people that are skeptic. So you know that I'm not telling you stories here. And you know I'm not exaggerating. I'm very careful with what comes out of my mouth, especially in the lectures. Because one mistake, after you say a million good things, you make one or two mistakes, you're done. In this business, there's no forgiveness. You have a lot of critics, a lot of reshaim out there that are sitting and waiting and praying and reading Tehillim to catch me make mistake. Yes. You don't understand. There are thousands of wicked people in the world that listens to me word by word every day. But for only one reason. To find something that I say that I can put in the internet and make fun. That's all they do. Every day, 2 hours, they sit and listen to last night's lecture. Word by word. They have no intention to be righteous. All they want is to be clowns and wicked and destroy the Torah and make more people become not religious. But you are not like this, Baruch Hashem. You, Baruch Hashem, still have a Jewish heart and you really want to be righteous, and I'm sure you don't want to get Hashem upset at you, and you're also smart enough to know that whatever I do now, later on, I'm going to have to pay. And the reason that Hashem does not punish us right away when we commit a sin is because if everyone who commits a sin will get the punishment a minute later, obviously nobody will ever make sins. If you laugh at someone, and as soon as you finish the sentence, you got a punch to your face. You try to laugh at another person, punch on the other side. You got the point. You will never laugh at people. If you stole $100 from a customer, a second later you just lost $200. You tried to steal now $200 to get the $200 you just lost, and you lost $400. You stole $400, you lost $800. What's going on here? Everything I steal, I lose double right away. Will I ever steal? No. Not because I'm honest. Not because I'm righteous. Not because I believe that that's the right thing to do, not to steal. No. Only one reason. What is the reason? I know right away I pay the price. Okay. Now, if every mitzvah I do, every good thing I do, I get the reward right away. I help a poor person, right away, a minute later, I made double. I gave him $1,000 gift for his family for Shabbat because they're poor. 2 minutes later, I see in my account, someone wired $2,000. I went, I helped another poor guy, gave him $500. A minute later, I just made $1,000. I check. Every time I give someone or have mercy on the poor or help the widow or help the orphan or give a nice gift to righteous people or to the yeshiva, immediately I make double. What would you do from this moment on? None of you will go back to your businesses. None of you will open the store anymore. None of you will even touch nothing. All you would do all day, sit by your computer and send wires into holy people's account. Rabbi, I'm sending you 10,000. Wow, you just sent me yesterday 10. Don't ask question. Tell me if you got it. You wouldn't go to the store. The money that you have now, you can double it every hour. Every hour. You send 1 million, you just have 2 million. Send 2 million, you have 4 million. Who would go and open the store all day, fight with customers? So obviously Hashem cannot make the world with instant respond, because it's not going to be free choice. Everyone would become a robot. No one would kill. No one would steal. No one would speak Lashon Hara. Everyone would give non-stop tzedakah. No one would open business. We won't have what to eat. Who is going to be the fool to go and plant seeds in the ground? When you can just trade money non-stop. Hey, widow, come here. Take from me. No, no, I already took from him. Take also from me. Not because you care about her. Not because you care about the Torah, because you want to double your money. So obviously the world cannot go on when you see right away what the Torah say that will happen. Because then everyone will be righteous and there's no point. This is a place of a test. Where exactly is the test? There's no test. Now when you break Shabbat and you open your business, and Shabbat you make more than what you make all week. You're a barber, Bukharian barber. Every day you make $100. Not many people come in a weekday in the middle of business hour to have a haircut. Shabbat, everyone is off. 40 customers you did today. 40 haircuts, usually you do 10. $400 you made to your pocket. Is this stupid rabbi tell me to close on Shabbat? I close on Shabbat, I will starve. That's the test. You trust me that I feed you, or you think you make your money from cutting people's hair? Who do you think feed you? The business? The efforts that you do? The college? Being a doctor? That's what makes you make money? How many people who do not know how to write their name in English make millions? How many here in America? Plenty. How many professors that went to the best university are unemployed already for 2 years collecting food stamps? How many taxi drivers make more than lawyers? Uber drivers. Some Uber drivers can get to $80,000 a year. I know lawyers, 2-3 years out of law school, making 45 in Manhattan. Take all the other expenses. 45. Lawyer. 45. If you came out of Harvard Law School, $200,000. Still not that much. An average Bukharian who doesn't say two words in English make more than a barbershop. So who is smarter, the lawyer from Harvard or Boris from Uzbekistan? Huh? Who is smarter? You got the point? You got the point. Any more questions?
Yes, Rabbi. Did Hashem ever come out of Shabbat?
Did
Hashem ever finish Shabbat? Did he ever come out of Shabbat?
Come out of Shabbat in what way?
He was the seventh day he rested.
Yeah.
And then it stopped.
Then he did Avdalah. Then it started Sunday. He went to Shachrit.
Yeah.
Sunday morning.
Okay.
Yeah.
Couple of questions. Sounds a little ignorant, I guess. They say that everything is predetermined for you before your soul gets set in this world.
Yeah.
All the decisions are made, all your life and everything. Your main choice is whether you're going to be good or bad.
That's it. Everything physical is determined by Hashem. Everything spiritual is your choice. You choose.
Okay, so if you decide to be good, right? But okay, so you're not keeping Shabbat and all that stuff, but you're good. You're not.
There's no such thing. You can never be a good human being if you break Shabbat. I tell you why. Because if you're nice to people, you help, you know, you behave very nice around them, you're not hurting anyone, everyone likes you, you know, you have good sense of humor, you're very friendly, but you spit at your father all the time. You beat up your father, you give him smacks to his face, but you're nice to everyone. If I will come and say that you're a good person, people will kill me. You're calling him good person? He spits at his father. His father did everything for him, and the one thing his father asked from him, and he not only doesn't listen, he makes fun at his own father. How can you be a good person when you're nice to people, but you go against your creator who give you oxygen every second to breathe? Not to talk about all the other gifts you get from him. There's no such thing. There's no such thing. Because if a person is nice to the whole neighborhood, but he spits on his father and beat him up on the street and kick him when he walks in the street, no one in the neighborhood will dare to say that he's a nice person. You got the point? That's it. Second question.
If you decide to become Baal Teshuva, right?
Yes.
If you decide, a lot of people are in this room, and you decide to keep Shabbat.
Okay.
And maybe all the holidays.
Yes.
But that's when you stop. You say, I keep Shabbat. That's the most important thing in the
Torah. Yes. Yes. Yes.
How do you look at that?
It's a huge progress. Huge. You went from almost zero to 80, 90 already. That's a very big thing, because even if a person is wicked, but he kept Shabbat, first of all, he died as a Jew. Okay? All right. Second, the Zohar explained what happened to people that are wicked, but they also kept Shabbat. But they did a lot of other bad things, Lashon Hara, yet not kosher, sex crimes, things like this. What happened to these people? First of all, one day a week, they have rest in Gehenom. It's already 14%. One out of seven, it's 14%. So 14% in Olam Haba, there's rest from Auschwitz. So that's already a huge achievement. However, if someone is Shomer Shabbat, Hashem will do everything to help him to do tshuva. But if he's not Shomer Shabbat, no matter how good he is in everything else, it won't help him. Because he gets karet, he's mamash like a goy, chalel Shabbat, areu kegoy, even if he's a nice person, even if he's baal tzedakah, even if he puts tefillin, even if he does a lot of other good things, mechalel Shabbat, areu kegoy lechol davar. Only two things make a person lose his Judaism. Mechalel Shabbat and Avodah Zarah. Nothing else. Not murder, not stealing, not sex crimes. Sex crimes are very big punishments in the Torah. But a person stay a Jew. But Mechalel Shabbat and Avodah Zarah, he loses his Jewish identity. It's a very big thing.
What about seven laws of Noah?
The Goyim keep seven laws of Noah. It's not that you become a goy to give you a prize. It's a penalty. Do you understand the difference? You still are obligated to keep all the mitzvot. But you should know one thing, the Goyim has heaven. If the Goyim kept the Sheva Mitzvot Bnei Noach, and they're good, decent people, and they love Jews, and they're not anti-Semite, when they die, they go to heaven of Goyim. So I always said there will be hundreds of millions of Goyim that goes to heaven of Goyim. And there will be, unfortunately, 80% of the Jewish people are Mechalelei Shabbat who have no share to the world to come. God forbid.
What about the 10 people that went into the other world without dying?
Without dying.
Some of them were going to?
Yes.
So what heaven did they go to?
They went to heaven of Goyim. Jews and Goyim do not go to the same heaven. And they don't have the same hell as well. There's total separation between Jews and Goyim in this world and in the next world. And that's why when a person dies, if Hashem wants to send his soul back to the world, if he was Jewish, he comes back as a Jew. If he was a Goy, he comes back as a Goy.
So yes. Goyim, in Avodah Zarah, they also...
Goyim that did Avodah Zarah, they broke the Sheva Mitzvot Bnei Noach. It's death penalty for them. So and they lost their heaven. All Christians who believe in J.C. Penney, they don't have a share to the world to come. But the Muslims, that they don't believe in any idol, they believe in one God, they just were fooled by their parents that they thought that Muhammad is a prophet and the Quran is another book of God. And if they keep the Sheva Mitzvot Bnei Noach, they don't murder, they don't support murder, they don't worship idol, they don't eat animals unless they're dead, and they don't steal, and they don't make sexual crimes among the relatives. They believe in one God, and they obey the court and the police in their country. They go to heaven. If you hate the Jew, you have a problem with the king of the world, because he took the Jewish people and he made them his children. So if you come to the king, if you come to Saddam Hussein, Lehavdil, and you tell them, I like you, but I hate your son. I wish I can kill them. What will happen? It won't help you that you're a nice person. You go after my sons and you tell it to me? So what? Look at these Arabs. I never believe how dumb they can be. Because some of them, they don't steal because they're afraid of God. Some of them, they won't make sex crimes because they're afraid of God. They don't worship idols because they're afraid of God. But they hate the Jews. And when they come to the mosque, they pray to God to help them to eat Bach El Yahud. So I say, how dumb you can be, you fool. You read in the Torah that you yourself believe in. That's why your name is Ibrahim. Where your name Ibrahim or Yusuf came from? From the Torah. You believe in all the stories of the Torah. And you read in the Torah that Hashem loved the Jews the most. And what you come to Hashem? Help me to kill your children. You see how dumb they are? Not all. Some Arabs are not like this. You will be surprised. They are, percentage-wise, there's not that many. But there are some Arabs. You can see them in the internet. They are. I don't know how brave they are. That they speak that the Jews are the chosen people and that Israel belongs to them. And there's no such thing Palestine or Palestinians. There are Arabs like this. But most of the Arabs who think like this, you won't hear them. Because they risk their life. It's a very big problem. If you're an Arab, by Arabs there's no traders. There's no such thing to be a lefty. If you are a lefty trader, you are dead. Only in Israel you become the prime minister if you're a trader. But by the Arabs, if you're a trader, you and your family are dead the next day. You understand? There's no such thing to betray that. You don't want us? Leave the country. If it was up to me, I would make rule number one in Israel. That every Israeli citizen, whether he's a Jew, whether he's a Goy, regardless, will say in public anything against the country that helped the Goyim to go against us, will make boycott Israel, BDS, do this, do that, immediately he loses citizenship. Right away he comes to court, the judge dismisses his citizenship, he has 72 hours to leave the country, can never come back to Israel. Half of Israel would live in a month. If you see what they write in the internet against their own country, they cooperate with the Arabs, they cooperate with the Europeans, with anti-Semites. You cannot believe what's happening. Half of our country is traitors. Half. That's why in the election all the time it's 50-50. 50% left, 50% right. Like in America, 50% Republicans, 50% Democrat. What's Democrat? Also betrayed Hashem. abortions, gays, gay marriage, all the corruption. Democrats, anti-God. Republican, they're not pro-God. Don't get confused. They're far away from being righteous. But they're not as bad. So if you have bad and worse, you go with the bad. What can you do? Yes?
Some people, they try to keep Shabbat and thinking that they're keeping Shabbat. But there's so much more to Allah. Well, how to improve and make it stronger to keep Shabbat? Like at that moment, you know, sometimes people keep Shabbat for a couple of weeks.
If you're not educated, you don't know how to keep Shabbat and you don't know how to keep any other mitzvah. So you have to learn. You get books about Shabbat for beginners. You learn. You begin to learn the laws. You go to the synagogue. The rabbis give speeches. They have learnings in almost every shul. You come to the learning. After a year, you won't recognize yourself how good you became. I remember I lived in Manhattan. I used to go to Lower East Side to the shul with the American Ashkenazim over there. The rabbi used to give shiurim between Mincha and Arvit and Shabbat after the davening, between Mincha and Ma'ariv. Just from the 10 minutes, 15 minutes, half an hour, you know how much I learned in the first year? If you come, you learn a lot. Plus, you listen online. You have my app for free. Start with my app, you finish age 200. You have a lot to catch. There's 20,000 hours of lectures. So start. Let's see if you finish by age 200. Maybe in your next Gilgul you finish. So you have plenty of things to learn. There's so many lectures, so many topics. You learn so much about life, Jewish hashkafa, Jewish ideology, marriage, raising children, honesty in a business, kosher food, Shabbat, holidays, so many things. By the way, life is very interesting when you are religious. Life is very boring when you are not religious, and I'll tell you what I mean. I know what you're thinking. It should be the other way around. People that are not religious, they watch sport, they watch movies, they play poker, they go to games, they go to Cancun, they go to places they can eat whatever they want, they can make any sins they want, they don't even look at that as a sin. So life is free. That's why almost all secular people in deep depression. Almost everyone in America is on Prozac. Divorce rate, more than 70%. Children in crime and drugs, almost everybody. No peace in the family. No peace with the in-laws. No peace with the brothers. Everyone wants to kill everyone. Partners wants to kill each other. Neighbors wants to kill each other. Life is full of stress. Here and there you find a secular person that have relatively okay life. But almost everyone who comes to me, when they begin to complain about the problems, I'm almost fainting from the things that are happening in their life. This one, his daughter married an Arab from Africa. This one, his son just told him he's gay. This one that. This one, his brother killed the other brother because the father did not write his name in a business. Non-stop problems. But when you become religious, one of the things that happen is you have emunah. You have faith in Hashem. You live with faith. You don't kill anymore for money. You cut the stealing. You are happy with what Hashem gives you because now in your mind you know this is what my father wants me to have. And he said in the Torah, if this is what I give you, that means that's the best thing for you. I would not give you something that's bad for you. So life, you look at life completely different. When you're sick, it's not the end of the world. Ask the doctors in Manhattan, in York Avenue. Someone told me, the doctor told him, your chance to get cured is 15%. He had serious cancer. That's the statistic. But don't worry. I have good news. You, the religious people, have their own statistic. More than 40% chance to get cured. He got saved, this guy. He asked him why. He said, I don't know, you have something with your God. The statistic that worked by everyone, Jews and non-Jews, not religious people, 15% come out of this kind of cancer. By you people, it's a whole different statistic. Why? Because when you live with faith in Hashem, it changes your fortune. David HaMelech said, "Emanti ki adaber." You know why I believe? Because I speak a lot about it. speak about Hashem, I speak about Torah, I speak about Emunah, I become a believer. We also say it in the Torah, Yehi chasdecha Hashem aleinu, kaasher ichalnu lach. Your kindness on us, Hashem, will be based on how much we are hoping for you. Kaasher ichalnu lach. The more I'm counting on you, the more you will do for me. That's the mathematical formula. The more you rely on yourself, the more you have to do for yourself. And Hashem will do less for you. The more you rely on Hashem, the more He does for you, and the less you have to do. So which one, which kind of life you want? Life that you are a slave, full of sadness and stress and frustration, and kill yourself to make it? Or life that Hashem is serving you? Hashem, I need this. Counting on you. Abba, take care of problems. Ashlech ya'avcha al Hashem, ve'hu yechalkelecha. Throw everything on me, I will do it for you. But only in one condition. What is it? Only in one condition. That you really believe in me. Some people say, I'm believing, I believe, I believe. You steal $100 from him, he called Tony from the mafia. Tony, I have a job for you. What? My cousin did not pay me on the last deal. That's not a believer. That's no believing. Also, if I give you, you come to me with the bucket and I am the faucet. I give you as much water as you want. But you come to me with bucket that have holes. My help to you will help or no? What will my answer to you would be? Don't be stupid. I have plenty for you. Fix the holes. Fix the holes in the bottom. If you fix the holes in the bottom, now I'm going to be able to really give you. But if you are Mechalel Shabbat, I'm giving you, but everything goes to the garbage because there's no blessing. Because the rule in life is, Shabbat is the source of everything. Last question for today.
Oh, can you give?
Yeah.
What's the best way a person can work on his midot and work on his midot?
The best way to work on the midot, from my experience, is to listen to a lot of Musar lectures by speakers that shake your stomach. You understand? So, right here I brought Path of the Just, Mesilat Yesharim, 30 hours, how to fix the midot. I brought a series, a Way of the Righteous, 2 CDs, 60 hours, 30 and 30. How to fix the midot. Right there you have 90 hours, how to fix the midot. I promise you, if you listen to it carefully, after 90 hours that you listen, you won't recognize yourself. It changed your entire being, who you are, your ego, your arrogance, your anger, your laziness, everything is gone. Because Hashem made the world that the more you learn, the more you change. The less you learn, you're not connected, the soul is dying. If you connect, it's like charging the phone. You need a source. You charge it, you get charged. You don't, you are dying out. No, last question.
So what about when parents who are not religious, but the children are religious?
Okay.
What zechut do the parents have from their children in Olam Haba?
Sometimes these parents have zechut, and sometimes they don't have zechut. Zechut means merit. If the parents promote religion for their children, the father knows, I'm a loser. Why should my son be a loser like me? At least let him be tzaddik. If I wasn't, at least let him be tzaddik. He let him learn. He gives him money. He let him keep Shabbat. He respects. He doesn't fight him. He doesn't all day fight with him. Look at you, you're religious, you're crazy, what you're doing, this, all day praying. What is this kippah? What is this tzitzit? I'm not buying you kosher food, that's your problem. I'm not going to spend money on you. If he's not like that, then everything that the son does will help the father as well. But if the father fights that his son should not be religious, should not go to shul, should not eat kosher, should not keep Shabbat, and on purpose he blasts the TV that when he prays, when he does Birkat HaMazon, not only he doesn't have any zchut in his son's action, he will be severely punished for trying to bring him down. Because the Gemara says, Gadol amachti'o yoter min ahorgo. Someone that make another Jew go down in his religion is worse than killing him physically. So if when you kill him physically, you get a death penalty, I don't have to tell you what happened if he was here and you brought him down in religion, what's going to be the punishment? Even if it's your own son. So now it's the pen. Some parents support. I have secular parents. You have to see how happy they are when they have two sons in yeshiva, in Israel. This is my son, is in yeshiva here. This is my son. You have to see how they are happy. And then you have the other kind of parents. My son went to yeshiva, such a loser. How much I put in him to go for college, and look what he did. Maybe you can tell him to come out of yeshiva to finish his college. All they care is about their show-off. What are they going to say to your friends, to their friends? They don't care that he's going to become Talmid Chacham, Tzaddik. They're not interested in it. I know one guy, his father used to chase him on the highway to the point that he got him off the road, almost flipped over. That's how crazy that rich father was. Because his son did not want to follow him to college, into business, and all day was learning Torah. But Baruch Hashem, the father left him after a few years. He left him alone, he gave up. And this guy became very religious, got married, religious girl, and make millions. That's besides the point. I don't get it. Some of these parents, they have so much money that they can sponsor their son until 500 years without even worry about it. And they go crazy if they won't go to college. Like, he needs the college. How much is going to make out of college? How much, you fool? 50, 80, 100? You're making millions of dollars every year. Get him in a business. Why are you making him waste 5-6 years? With all the goyot over there, with the gays and all the kofrim. Why? Get him in a business. Wow, he's only 19. Either send him to yeshiva. You don't want him in yeshiva. Get him in a business. But it's not for my business. He doesn't know how to do what I do. Open him another business. If your son is not mature, where do you think he's going to be mature the fastest? Only in yeshiva. When you're in yeshiva, it's like the Israeli army and better. You come, after 2 years they are in Israel for yeshiva, you don't recognize your son anymore. Responsible, get up in the morning, take care of things, focus. The yeshiva, it's a heaven. Even for secular parents, they have to thank God a million times that my son wants to go to yeshiva. What's better, he'll be on the street playing cards, gambling on the internet, and smoking drugs all day? How many millions of Americans all day like this, smoking grass and lay on the bed all day? Age 28 in his father's living room. But if you say to the father, what would you prefer? That your son will be like this or will be a serious religious boy in yeshiva? You know, kippah, tzitzit. Oh, no, religious, God forbid. To the point that one stupid Israeli brain surgeon, Dr. Miller, I don't know if he's alive, 20-something years ago I read an article about him in the Israeli newspaper. His son became religious, Baal Tshuva. This brain surgeon was so upset. You had to see how he talks about his son, like his son is a murderer. So the reporter, which is also a lefty secular guy, it's a lefty newspaper, he said to him, listen, I'm not religious, and I'm not pro-religion, but it looks to me that you went a little bit too far with the way you speak about your son. You sound like your son is a heavy drug user. Like a heroin addict. This stupid surgeon answered him, I would rather my son be an heroin addict than become religious. And I was thinking to myself, I hope I'm not going to ever have brain problems. That he's going to operate on me, this Rasha Merusha. And can you call someone like this smart? He has a degree. He went to medical school. He's a brain surgeon. How many people can be brain surgeon? 1 out of 1,000? Not even. He cannot be stupid. So you see, educated and smart has nothing to do with each other. You can be totally not educated. Primitive, number one in business, number one in thinking, number one in making peace between people, number one in smelling crooks. A lot of things. You didn't even go to college. You didn't finish high school. You can be a law graduate from Harvard, a lawyer, president of the United States, dumber than a shoe, Hussein Obama. Cannot be more stupid than this guy. Can't be. Every decision is mamash, like you're talking to the wall. Every decision is against human logic. Pro-terrorist, pro-Iran, pro-gay, pro-changing the sex. So what kind of a human being this is? 150 billion gifts to Iran, protecting them. What's going on over here? What do you see? Just because you are educated and read a lot of books, or you have good memory, or you're working very hard because you're greedy for money, that doesn't make you smart. Smart, you see, in my life I learned with a lot of people in the past. Some of them were not educated at all from their background, but they were very sharp. Some of them were very intelligent, making such a good impression, but in the Gemara they're dumb. They can't understand the depth of the Gemara. You see that all the time. I once learned with a Persian guy, I made him religious. I picked him up from an apartment with Israeli guys. There's six or seven of them lived together. He had hair like this, curly hair like this. He was dressed like an Indian idol worshiper. He had a necklace. I'll never forget the first time I saw him. He was laying on a mattress in the living room. Someone took me to that house to give them a lecture to these Israeli boys. Middle of the day, 2 p.m., they're all sleeping from the drugs. And he had a necklace. You know the melon seeds? Melon seeds. So you dry them, you clean them, you put them in the sun, they become dry. You take a needle and you make a necklace from them. That used to be in style. He had a necklace like this. And he was wearing what they call in Israel, shawal. Some kind of a... I looked at him, I said, how am I going to make this bomb religious now? That day, it was enough for him. He was a very clever guy. He listened to everything. I brought him into the yeshiva. Few months later, he became my chevruta. You had to see what sechel this guy has. Persian, sharp. And today is a big diamond salesman. But back then, when we were learning together, this guy was a killer. You go one tiny little bit from the truth of the Gemara, he catches you. You can never, ever go a little bit off the track. But some other people, you can take them in circles. They don't understand left or right. But this guy, plus I had one Yemenite guy, like this, small like this. You had to see what a brain he had. Totally uneducated. Nothing, didn't even finish elementary school. Became Baal Tshuva. You had to see how he learned. You take the number one doctor in the world, put him together with him in a Gemara, the doctor will jump from the terrace. What brain he had, this guy. Skinny, all the time, he's cold. He walks like this, like he's tired from life. You know these people, they say, well, when will I die already? He comes until he opens the Gemara. It takes him 2 minutes to open the Gemara. Sits like this, like he just woke up. As soon as he begins to learn, machine gun. He can't keep up with him. This, that, this, here. He remembers this. He puts it together. Here, that. What's going on over here? Can't keep up with him. So you see, wisdom and sharpness, first, it's a gift from Hashem. Second, is a lot of activation of the brain. A lot of people in America, nobody even knows 6 times 7. Kids need calculator. When we grew up, there's no calculator. You're not allowed to use calculator in school. Today, it's in the test they use calculator. We had to figure it out. I remember when I came to America, my first job, I didn't know how to use the cash register. So I press a button and open the register, and I gave change. The guy, the owner, this guy came to me, what is this? You're stealing money? Let me check your pocket. Baruch Hashem, I was broke. Didn't have any money. He checked my pocket. My first day at work. He said, why you don't type the cell? This bagel, this snapple, coke. I said, I do it while I'm making the bagels. What? How can it be? I said to him, yes. A bagel with butter, three bagels with cream cheese, bagel with tuna, two coke, this, that. I calculate everything in my head. He called his wife. You believe this guy? I want to see. Do bagel with butter, two bagels with cream cheese, bagel with vegetable cream cheese. He was giving me. I said, no problem. Ta 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 ta. I opened it. Here, this is the change. He checked. He had to see how they looked at me. Like I'm a UFO from a different planet. And for me, it was I was only a few days in America. This is 1989. For me, it was every Israeli is like this. What we learn in school, we learn math in high level. By the way, today it's not like this anymore. Israel is just as bad as here today. I'm talking to you a long time ago. Today it's also the same thing. Everyone is into the internet. No one is into the learning. But back then, you had to see, they call me the Israeli Einstein. Why? Because I know how to calculate how much change to give from $20 bill. Do you understand what's going on here, Rabotai? The brain doesn't think. 30 years, your brain never thought, it become rust. Rusty. I want to thank you very much. Please take CDs. Take CDs. Bezrat Hashem. Thank you very much. Baruch Adonai Leolam. Amen.